midst of this decidedly memorable election season, a season that has confounded political scientists and astounded political pundits, it's my great pleasure to introduce today's Common Hour speaker, Professor of Government Stephen Medvic. An expert on political campaigns and voter behavior, Stephen has provided political analysis for the Washington Post, Philadelphia Inquirer, and Richmond Times-Dispatch, and other publications, and has appeared on a host of other forums, including NBC Nightly News, CNN, Fox News Online, and the NewsHour with Jim Lehrer on PBS. He's the author of several books, most recently, In Defense of Politicians, The Expectations Trap and Its Threat to Democracy. Prior to joining the Department of Government at Franklin and Marshall in 2002, Dr. Medvic taught for several years at Old Dominion University and served as a research fellow at Old Dominion Social Science Research Center. Dr. Medvic earned bachelor's degrees in political science and philosophy from Texas A&M University and a master's and PhD in political science from Purdue University. On the heels of Monday night's presidential debate, Stephen will be analyzing the 2016 presidential election for us today, explaining who is winning more broadly and why, as well as set the race in the broader context of political polarization and the negative views partisans have of the other party. Appointed to the Honorable and Mrs. John C. Kunkel Chair of Government in 2015, Stephen's talk today is part of the Endowed Chair Lecture Series. Please join me in welcoming Professor Stephen Medvic.
Thank you, Joel, for that kind introduction. And thank you all for being here. I'm glad that Cindy reminded you that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is next week, because I had this terrible fear that people would think it was this week. And when Provost Martin introduced me, everybody just got up and left. So thanks for being here, and thanks especially for staying, I guess. On an almost daily basis, I'm reminded of just how lucky I am to teach at a place like Franklin and Marshall College. The history of the institution and the intellectual vitality and fundamental decency of the people make this a special place to work and study. I'm proud to be a part of the faculty here, and I'm honored to have been appointed to the Kunkel Chair of Government. I don't think I'm capable of expressing how truly grateful I am to the college. And one doesn't get many opportunities to thank publicly the people who have meant so much in one's life and career, so if you'll indulge me for a moment, I'd like to do that. My government department colleagues are remarkable teachers and scholars, and to a person, they have helped me become a better teacher and scholar. The government department has a storied history and a long-standing commitment to helping students become not only engaged and critical citizens, but also dedicated public servants. One of the founding members of the government department, John Vanderzell, passed away this summer. Those of us in the department today owe him and Sid Wise and Dick Shear an enormous debt of gratitude for establishing such a strong tradition of teaching, scholarship, and service. I also want to thank Stanley Mikulak, Bob Gray, Joe Karleski, Greer Stevenson, and Bob Friedrich for their tremendous contributions to the department and to F&M. The rest of us have an awesome responsibility to continue your great work, but I have no doubt that my senior colleagues and the amazing junior faculty in the department are up to the task. There are far too many colleagues to name in other departments around campus whom I consider mentors, role models, and friends. I'm constantly learning from these colleagues, and their generosity seems to know no bounds. We have a world-class faculty here at F&M, and I hope the students in the audience realize how fortunate you are to have them as professors. We faculty are certainly fortunate to have students as impressive as F&M students are. They're creative, intelligent, and hardworking, and I want to thank the students I've had over the years for challenging and inspiring me. Without my wife Laura's love, support, and patience, especially during election season, I wouldn't be able to do half of what I do. Those of you who know her know that she's a kind, smart, and extremely gracious person. What you may not know is that she's also a news junkie and a very insightful political analyst. For those and innumerable other reasons, I'm incredibly lucky to share my life with her. My father, Steve, who passed away in 2006, and my mother, Nancy, who is here today in the front row, have given me what every child needs, unqualified love and support throughout my life. Neither of them attended college, but they modeled intellectual curiosity for me and they instilled in me a respect for education and a love of learning that enabled me to go to college and then essentially stay in college for the rest of my life. Thank you, Mom. Finally, I'd like to thank the Kunkel family for their generous support of Franklin and Marshall and of the government department in particular. Congressman Kunkel represented Central Pennsylvania in Congress from 1939 to 1950, and again from 1961 to 1966. His voting record indicates that while he wasn't exactly a liberal, he was in the left wing of the Republican Party. He was about as close to a true moderate as you can possibly get. This slide shows where on the left-right spectrum his voting record falls. It's called a DW nominate score, which is an acronym, and it maps legislators in issue space. So essentially it's a measure of how far left or right the voting record of a member of Congress is. His average score over the course of his 18-year career, as you can see, is 0.129, quite centrist. For comparison purposes, the average score for Pennsylvania Republicans in the last Congress was 0.555, and Pennsylvania's most liberal or least conservative Republican in Congress right now scored a 0.4 in the last Congress. Now, if you're curious, the overall Republican average in the last Congress was 0.7, and the Democratic average was negative 0.371. It's negative because it's on the other side of the spectrum. We call this asymmetric polarization. That is, the Republican Party has moved further to the right than the Democratic Party has moved to the left. Representative Kunkel also voted on the liberal side of some of the 20th century's most historic pieces of legislation, such as the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, and the 1965 Social Security Amendments, which created Medicare and Medicaid. Now, 80% of House Republicans voted for the Civil Rights and Voting Rights Acts, and a very slim majority of Republicans, 69 to 68, voted for the final version of the Medicaid and Medicare bill. The fact that a majority of Republicans voted for key elements of the liberal Great Society tells you how different that time was from our own. Indeed, there was far less polarization in Congress back then, and as this graph indicates. It shows the difference between the average Democratic DW nominate score and the average Republican score over time. As you can see, the gap between the two parties has grown tremendously. In fact, it's more than doubled over the 80 years on this graph. Now, many of you are thinking, I'm sure, we need more Representative Kunkels in Congress. We need more liberal Republicans and conservative Democrats. Surely they would help bridge the divide that now exists between the two parties. Well, as much as we might like to have more Congressman Kunkels, they're not coming back. Political polarization is here to stay, as I'll explain later. As a matter of fact, polarization is critical for understanding this year's election. So let's turn to the current state of the race. And I'm probably going to talk fast, so keep up, because there's a lot to say about this election. These are a couple of poll aggregations. Real Clear Politics and the Huffington Post pollster aggregate all the polls. One of them includes some polls, the other includes different polls, so that's why the numbers aren't exactly the same. But what you can see, and I've listed two of the two-way averages, which is Clinton versus Trump, and then two of the four-way averages, which include the minor party candidates, Johnson and Stein. But what you can see is that Clinton leads in all these scenarios, anywhere from 2.7 points to 4.5 points. So roughly this is, I think this is roughly a 3 to 3.5 point Clinton lead as we stand today. So why is it so close? Many of you might think, well, shouldn't she be doing better? She's running against an unconventional candidate who's made all kinds of what we normally would call gaffes, but they don't seem to have much impact. So why is this so close? I should note that this is precisely what leading political science forecasting models would predict. I don't have time to go through all the models, but I just want to give you a sampling of what these forecasting models are saying this year. So this first one is by James Campbell. It's called the convention bump. It takes into account the state of the economy, but also pre and post convention polls. And he thinks the Democrats should win this year with 51.2% of the vote. The next model is Alan Abramowitz's Time for Change. This takes into account presidential approval, one measure of the economy, but also whether the incumbent party is looking for a third term or not. That turns out to be important. He thinks the Republicans are going to win with 51.4% of the vote. And I should say, remember this model, because I'm going to come back to it. This model has the best track record over time. So we'll come back to the time for change model. There's a model that takes into account leading economic indicators, and it says the Democrat will win with 52% of the vote. There's another one that looks at how the candidates did in their primaries. So what was their strength against their opposition to get the nomination? This model says the Republican will win with 52.5% of the vote. It's another political economy model says the Democrat will win 51.1. And finally, there's another sort of aggregate model put together by two political scientists for Vox, the website. And they say when you put it all in a stew and mix it up, the Republican should win with 50.9% of the vote. Now, I should also point out that these forecasting models have a somewhat mixed record. They don't do a very good job of accurately predicting the percentage of the vote, the final percentage of the vote, but they have had a very, very good record at accurately picking which party's gonna win the election. Typically, all the signs point in one direction. This year they don't. They're pretty evenly split between the Democrat and the Republican. One other thing I should note about these models is that they don't take into account the candidates or their campaigns at all. Some of them do sort of because they take into account poll standing in the summer. And to that extent, they take into account who the candidates are and maybe how they're doing sometime in the middle of the summer. But most of these models are based on things the candidates have no control over: the state of the economy, the sitting president's approval rating, whether they're going for a third term or whatever. So without knowing anything at all about the candidates or about their campaigns, we would expect a very, very close election this year. I think, in fact, when you look at the fundamentals, the things that typically determine the outcome of elections, and again, the things that candidates can't control, you would think that not only is it going to be close, but the Republicans probably have an edge this year. Let's run through those fundamentals just quickly. GDP growth in the first half of 2016 was 1%. What previous research shows is that the incumbent party will benefit from the state of the economy when growth is 1.5 to 2%. So it's a little lower than the Democrats would like. There is good news, economic news out there. Unemployment rate is low. It's as low as it's been since early 2008. But it turns out that the unemployment rate, maybe surprisingly, doesn't have a significant impact on the outcome of elections, at least when you throw it into a statistical model. So the economy is not doing quite as good as the Democrats would like. President Obama's approval rating is on average right now at about 50.5%, but these models are put together in the middle of the summer. And so in July, President Obama's approval rating was 49%. Now it turns out 49% is the tipping point for whether the incumbent party does well, benefits from the president's approval or not. So if it's above 49, the incumbent party will do well, and below 49, they won't do as well. So this is just sort of neutral. The last factor, so this is essentially Abramowitz's model. The last factor is the party looking for a third term. There's something called a cost of ruling effect. The longer a party's in power, the harder it is to stay in power, which sort of makes sense in one way, but in another way you might think, well, if they're doing well, why couldn't they stay in power for decades? But what we see in all democracies is the longer you've been in power, the harder it is to stay in power. The way that gets translated into the United States is it's very hard to win a third straight term for a party. It's only happened once since FDR and Truman were in office, Reagan two terms, and the first George Bush. So it's very difficult to hold on to the White House for three terms. This is particularly true when the level of dissatisfaction in the country is as high as it is today. And this may be the most important thing to know about this election. I mean, you already know it and probably sense it. But one of the real drivers of this election is that people want change. And there is overwhelming evidence for this. So let me run through a little bit just quickly. Gallup, back in August, asked, are you satisfied or dissatisfied with the way things are going? 72% were dissatisfied. Bloomberg asked in August, if you think the nation's headed in the right direction or off on the wrong track. 68% wrong track. Quinnipiac asked if people agree or disagree with this statement. The old way of doing things no longer works, and we need radical change. Now, I would have thought putting radical in there would have kind of scared people off of agreeing with that. And they would have said, well, we want change, but radical, that's pushing it. The American public's not particularly radical. But in fact, almost two-thirds said they agreed or strongly agreed with the statement that we need radical change. And finally, and maybe most alarming or interesting, is that NBC Wall Street Journal asked, people if they prefer a candidate who, quote, will bring major change to the way government operates, even if it's not possible to predict what that change might be, or would prefer a candidate who would bring a steady approach to the way government operates, even if it means fewer changes to how things are now. 53%, now that's not overwhelming, but a majority, 53%, said, we want what I'm calling unpredictable change. Just roll the dice, you know, things could get worse, but they might get better, and we want change even if it's unpredictable. So people clearly aren't happy with the status quo, and they desperately want change. The economy and the president's approval rating are essentially neutral this year, not helping the Democrats all that much, not hurting them, but not helping. But the cost of ruling effect, the time for a change, is really working against them. So you would think that this year is an advantage for the Republicans. And that's what Abramowitz's model said. And remember, his has the best track record. However, at the annual meeting of the American Political Science Association just a couple of weeks ago, all these forecasters revealed their findings, and Abramowitz disavowed his own forecast. Abramowitz said, "It's wrong. I'm telling you, it's wrong this year. It's been the best predictor in the past, but he says it's wrong." Now, remember, most of these models, including Abramowitz's, make predictions without knowing anything about the candidates or their campaigns. So Abramowitz argued that this year the candidates are going to matter, and that's largely because one of them is so far outside the norm of what we think of as a presidential candidate, right? There's so much baggage there that's going to have some kind of statistically significant impact. In truth, both candidates are flawed. They may not be equally flawed, but they are both flawed. And they are extremely unpopular by historical standards. In a recent Monmouth University poll, 35% of the voters had a favorable opinion of neither candidate. 35% had a favorable opinion of neither candidate. The previous high, going back to 1984, was 9% in 1992. In 2012, it was 5%, and that's the norm. So in a typical year, about 5% of the electorate will say, I don't really like either of them. All right, this year, it's 35%. This is why 13% of the public in a recent poll said they would prefer a giant meteor hitting the earth to voting for either Clinton or Trump. I love this bumper sticker. I haven't found one yet, but I want to get my hands on one. I like the tagline, just end it already, which is not good for people who study elections, but you know, I know most people want it over. Now, barring a catastrophe like that, one of these candidates is going to win. So how are the voters assessing the two-party candidates? Well, clearly, more people think Clinton is qualified to be president. I don't know if you can read those numbers in the back, but this is a Quinnipiac poll from just a couple of weeks ago, and what it doesn't ask an either-or, it lists traits and says, does Clinton have these traits, and then lists them and says, does Trump have these traits? So you could say yes to both. All right, but 62% said Clinton was qualified to be president. Only 38% said Trump was. How about having the right kind of experience? Clinton has the advantage. What about caring about average Americans? Clinton has the advantage. Not as big an advantage here, but still an advantage. How about being level-headed, which is another way of saying temperament, right? Who has better temperament? 63% say Clinton is level-headed. 27%. This is Trump's worst trait. 27% say he's level-headed. Now, they tie on being a strong person, and they also basically tie on having good leadership skills. So those traits are sort of neutralized. The one place where Trump had an advantage was on honesty. 40% say he's honest. I hear the sighing and the guffawing. Don't shoot the messenger, I'm just telling you. So 40% say he's honest, 32% say Clinton is. So clearly, you know, not even a majority say he's honest. Neither candidate's doing well on this score, but he's got an advantage over her. Now, the problem for Clinton is that trustworthiness is one of the most important traits that people look for, and there are a number of studies that say, some studies say it's the most important thing people look for. So this is a real drag for her, but I think, nevertheless, that on average, I mean, overall, taking all the traits into account, she has an advantage on candidate evaluation, that she has an advantage here. She also is undeniably running a better campaign, at least in conventional terms. So she's raised a lot more money. I've kind of broken it down here by candidate and outside groups and party, but basically Team Clinton has raised about $860 million to Trump's $462 million, and half of that was raised by the Republican Party, so not really by him or his allied groups. She and her allies have run far more campaign ads. This slide is basically the summer, early June until middle of August. She spent $57 million in the summer on ads, and her allied outside groups spent $27 million. Trump spent zero. His outside groups spent $8.5 million. I mean, he's almost not even running a campaign, right? So she's clearly running a better conventional campaign. Trump ramped it up a little bit last month. He spent $14 million. His outside groups spent $3 million, but Hillary spent $33.5 million, and her outside groups spent $9 million. So if you total it all up, the Team Clinton has spent about $125 million on ads so far, and Team Trump has spent only $26 million. So ultimately, I think that, and I know this is what everybody's waiting for, ultimately, I think that her campaign advantage, her campaign resource advantage, but also the advantage she has in the Electoral College, which I'll get to next, are going to enable Clinton to win. I've got a disclaimer at the bottom that says this prediction is subject to revision at a later date, preferably after the election, that would be best. Things could change, there are some caveats coming, but I think the smart money right now says Clinton will win. So let's look at the Electoral College edge that she has, because this is pretty astounding. There are 40 states that have voted the same way for the same party in all four of the last presidential elections. 40 out of the 50 states have voted for the same party in all those elections, and those elections are fairly different, right? 2004 is different from 2000 because of 9/11. 2008, there's a financial collapse, so it's economic issues primarily. These are very, very different elections, and yet 40 states have a pattern of voting for the same party. So if those states stay true to form, and they may not, but if they do, Clinton starts with 242 electoral votes. Remember, you need 270 to win, so she's almost there if those states just stay put. Another five states went for one party in three of the last four elections. Those are Iowa, New Mexico, Indiana, North Carolina, and New Hampshire. Now, if they stay basically true to form, she's up to 257, which would mean she only has to win either Ohio or Virginia or Florida, and she wins. Or if she wins both Colorado and Nevada, she wins. So Trump has to run the table. Again, assuming all these states behave as they have in the past, he has to run the table, she doesn't. So she's got this pretty big advantage. Now here come the caveats. Maybe these solid states won't be so solid this year. You know, there's talk that Wisconsin and Michigan and even Pennsylvania are much closer than they have been in the past. So it's possible that this year Trump will turn the map upside down. It's also the case that turnout is really hard to predict this year. Right now, we see that Trump supporters are much more enthusiastic than Clinton supporters. And so Trump may not need that voter mobilization effort that Clinton's going to need. And maybe his voters will just naturally go to the polls without much of a nudge, and she's going to have some heavy lifting to get all of her voters to the polls. So turnout may be the difference. People think there might be a hidden Trump vote, that people are not telling pollsters they're for Trump, but they really will vote for him. I'm very skeptical about this. I don't think there's any evidence to suggest it, and actually some good evidence that it's not happening. There didn't seem to be that effect in the primaries. And if there was such an effect, you'd see him doing better in online polls than in live telephone polls, and he's not doing better on online polls. In fact, he's doing better in live telephone polls, if anything. So I don't think there's a hidden Trump vote, but there could be a wave election this year. One of these things that breaks at the very last minute one direction or the other. There are currently 15 to 18% of the electorate who are not telling pollsters now that they're for either Clinton or Trump. They're either for Johnson or Stein, or they're undecided. Now, traditionally what happens is the support for those minor parties shrinks as you get close to election day. But it's possible, I suppose, that those voters end up going to Trump. They may say, we want the unpredictable change. You know, we're fed up and we just want change no matter what it is. So it's possible that at the last minute all of these voters break toward Trump. Not likely, but it is possible. And then there's the possibility of an October surprise, right? One of these last-minute things, a terrorist attack, or something that shakes up the race. WikiLeaks is saying they've got more documents that they're going to drop in October. And so maybe there's, you know, maybe there's a bombshell there that will shake up the race. I don't know. So it's possible that Trump could win. It's possible. I still think that that Clinton has the advantage, and I still think the smart money is on her. Now, I think I've given you a lot of evidence for why we should expect a close race, but there's one other reason that I haven't mentioned. It's sort of a meta explanation for why the race is close, and that's political polarization. We often think that polarization is an elite phenomenon. Obviously, members of Congress are polarized, but the public often thinks we're not. We're all sort of moderates. We're all in the middle. There's consensus out in the country that the elites don't recognize. That is simply wrong. It's a myth that there is consensus or that there's not polarization among the electorate. Now, there's a debate in political science about just how polarized the public is or how they're polarized. It could be that they're just polarized in partisan terms, but not in terms of policy preferences or values. We don't have time to go into that, but just trust me, there's a lot of polarization. And in fact, I'll show you some of the evidence for that. Today, Republicans and Democrats are more consistently ideological than they were 10 years ago, and there are fewer moderates and ideologically misaligned partisans. So what this shows you is that by 2014, the ideological gap between the median Democrat and the median Republican on a 10-point ideological scale has widened. And the purple in the middle, which is made up of moderates and misaligned ideological partisans, so liberal Republicans and conservative Democrats, that's beginning to shrink. And people are becoming more consistently liberal Democrat or conservative Republican. This tells the same story in numbers. Back in 1972, the ideologically aligned partisans, liberal Democrats, conservative Republicans, there was a third of them in the public. Today, or in 2012, it was 55%. My hunch is it's even higher nowadays, which means then that the moderates and independents have shrunk, so have the ideologically misaligned partisans. People's dislike of the other party is pretty intense. 91% of Republicans and 86% of Democrats say they have an unfavorable view of the other party, but a majority in both parties, 58% of Republicans and 55% of Democrats, have a very unfavorable view. So we ask people, you know, do you have a favorable view or not? Is it very unfavorable or just somewhat unfavorable? A majority today, and that's way up from 1994, say they have a very unfavorable view, and it's so bad that, in fact, if you ask them, do you think the other party is a threat to the nation's well-being, large numbers in both parties will say yes. 45% agree with that statement. 45% of Republicans agree with that statement, and 41% of Democrats agree with that statement. It's so bad that more of us even dislike Vladimir Putin, dislike the other party's nominee than dislike Vladimir Putin. So 51% of Republicans have an unfavorable view of Putin, 67% of Democrats do, but 93% of Republicans and 86% of Democrats have unfavorable views of the other party's nominee, right? This is a kind of a tangent and a footnote, but I have to show you this because if there was one slide that sort of sums up this election, it might be this or the next one. So the same polling outfit asked this question about Putin back in 2014, the same exact question just 2 years ago. The Democrats were at just about the same level of unfavorability, about two-thirds of Democrats. But Republicans were at 76%. So today, 2 years later, they're down to 51% having an unfavorable view of Putin. That is a remarkable shift in just 2 years, and I'll let you guess why that's the case. But it shows that voters take cues from party leaders, right? They're taking cues from their party's nominee. All right, finally, this is my favorite slide of how much we've come to dislike the other party. In a national study of civic culture in 1960, respondents were asked how they would feel if their child married somebody from the other party. 5% of Republicans and 4% of Democrats say, well, we'd be displeased with that. Some scholars replicated the study and asked the question again in 2010. 49% of Republicans and 33% of Democrats in 2010 say, well, they changed the wording, they'd be unhappy. It's the same point, right? people have come to really dislike the other party. So obviously partisans have grown to dislike, maybe even despise the other party, but they haven't simultaneously become more favorable to their own party. Their attitudes about their own party have stayed constant. That's what this slide shows. So this is what we call a feeling thermometer. You ask people how warmly do you feel toward a person or a group, and 100 is very warm and 0 is very cold. You can see that going back to the Carter administration, Democrats and Republicans, that's the top two lines, have been constantly in the 70 to 80 point range for their own party. What's really changed is that the opinion of the other party has tanked, right? It was in the 40s, which is pretty neutral. It's now in the 20s, which is decidedly more negative. Political scientists call this negative partisanship. It's not that we like our party more. It's not even that we like our party slightly more and the other party slightly less. We like our party the same. We hate the other party. And it's why we should not be surprised that this race is close. It's also a major contributor to the dysfunction that we see in our political system today, which brings me to the final portion of my talk. I'll stop soon for questions, but before I do, I want to briefly address the current state of American democracy. There's a paradox at the heart of contemporary American politics. On the one hand, we're deeply polarized along partisan lines. As I've demonstrated, we have come to distrust and perhaps even despise the other party, the party that we don't identify with. On the other hand, we also dislike the very notion of political parties. Sometimes this distaste for parties expresses itself as a desire for something more than a two-party system, but typically it expresses itself as a fantasy that we could have a political system without parties. Let's deal with each part of this paradox in turn. There's no denying that the level of polarization in the country among elites and the rest of us is high. Earlier, I showed you this slide, which indicates that polarization in the House of Representatives, is at its highest point in 80 years. What I didn't show you was this slide, which extends the time frame back to 1879. Nor did I show you this slide, which shows polarization in the Senate going back to the same point in time. Both of these slides reveal that polarization is not a new phenomenon. Granted, our current level of polarization in both the House and the Senate is at record levels, but we were a polarized nation in the early part of the 20th century and at the end of the 19th century. Obviously, we were highly polarized during the Civil War, but also in the antebellum period and during the fight over the ratification of the Constitution before that. Polarization, in other words, is the norm in American politics. The point is that the post-World War II era, when Representative Kunkel was serving in Congress, and which so many people look back on as a golden age of bipartisan cooperation, was a historical anomaly. Furthermore, the consensus that appears to have existed in that period really just masks deep divisions that existed within the Democratic Party over civil rights. The New Deal coalition began to fray as early as 1948, and these intramural battles would eventually force conservatives out of the Democratic Party, leading to the ideological alignment of the parties and the polarization that we see today. Polarization is the norm not only in American politics. Indeed, it appears to be a feature of Democratic politics generally, and our level of polarization, it turns out, is not abnormally high. In fact, it's relatively low in comparative terms. The political scientist Russell Dalton has created a polarization index that can be used to compare polarization levels in different countries. In his initial analysis of the index, he examined 28 countries. The United States polarization score ranked 20th. 19 countries, including France, Germany, Israel, Japan, Netherlands, Spain, Sweden, and Switzerland, had higher levels of polarization. So polarization in the United States isn't unusual, and it may not even be particularly bad in comparative terms. But there is a difference between polarization over policy preferences and values and polarization of partisan feeling or affect. Disagreement over policy is to be expected in a democracy. However, demonization of others because of their partisan affiliation is dangerous. It's this type of polarization we need to resist. At this point, many of you may be tempted to blame partisanship and, by extension, political parties for the current dysfunction we see in American politics. Anti-party sentiment is in our DNA as Americans. Its most famous expression is found in Washington's farewell address, in which he warned, quote, in the most solemn manner against the baneful effects of the spirit of party. Washington thought parties were the worst enemy, his words, of popular government. He believed that partisanship would lead to jealousy and revenge and would motivate one group of citizens to try to dominate all others. It would ultimately end in despotism. Now, Washington also acknowledged that party spirit, quote, is inseparable from our nature, having its root in the strongest passions of the human mind. It exists, he maintained, under different shapes in all governments. About this, I think he's correct. Certainly, modern mass democracy is impossible without political parties, and party formation in democracies is virtually inevitable. Indeed, parties were forming right under President Washington's nose. By about the Third Congress, 1793 to 1795, partisan voting patterns had emerged. This is why Washington felt compelled to warn against parties on his way out of office. Parties are not only inevitable, they serve a number of valuable functions in a representative democracy, including providing a link between the public and their government and engaging the electorate and mobilizing their participation. Democracy, in short, needs parties. But those parties have to be healthy parties, particularly when there are only two of them, as in our system. Unfortunately, the Republican Party is not, right now, a healthy party. If you need evidence for this claim, look no further than the more than 100 current or former members of Congress, former members of presidential administrations, or party leaders in the Republican Party who have publicly announced that they cannot and will not vote for their party's nominee. This is an unprecedented level of party disunity. Most frustrating to these Republicans is the fact that their party's nominee is undermining their admittedly rather limited efforts to date to begin to reach out to minority, young, and female voters. These Republicans know that given the rapid demographic changes taking place in the country, the party cannot remain a party of white and largely white male voters and still be competitive at the national level. Perhaps the party establishment has only itself to blame for not condemning their nominee when he became the leader of the birther movement 5 years ago. Nevertheless, they've not been able to control the direction of their party for the last year, or perhaps the last 6 or 7 years dating to the rise of the Tea Party movement. Why they've not been able to do that is one of the more pressing questions for those of us who study American politics. At this point, however, the party has a choice to make. It could follow the path laid out in the Growth and Opportunity Report, also known as the party's autopsy, which was issued after Mitt Romney's 2012 loss. There, the party discussed the need to reach out in sincere ways to voters who the party had ignored or at least turned off over the last several decades. Or it could follow Trump's lead and continue to appeal to deep-seated resentments. Now, some of those resentments may be economic in nature. There's no doubt that millions of Americans are economically insecure and that they feel vulnerable in the face of mass changes in the global economy. But there is mounting evidence, much of it provided by the impressive work of Michael Tesler at UC Irvine, that racial resentment has emerged as a driving force behind the political attitudes of many Americans. Not all of them are in the Republican Party, of course, but a large and increasing number are. The party is going to have to come to grips with this fact. Racial resentment, it turns out, is a better predictor of support for Donald Trump than is any measure of economic insecurity. And racial resentment is now correlated with other political attitudes in a way that wasn't the case until recently. Here, for example, is the connection between racial resentment and perceptions of the economy. In 2004, the red horizontal line, one score on the racial resentment scale was unrelated to one's view of the economy. By 2012, the blue lines, it had become highly correlated. The higher you score on a racial resentment index, the worse you think the economy is doing. They were unrelated. Those two things were unrelated prior to the current era. So what changed? According to Tesler, it's that we elected an African-American president. In fact, when President Obama is associated with a policy or even a public figure, racial resentment will often predict one's opinion about the policy or public figure, even when controlling for party and ideology. Far from representing a move to a post-racial American politics, the Obama era has emboldened racist attitudes. Thus, the title of Tesler's recent book, Post-Racial or Most Racial? Sadly, the answer is the latter. While I'm recommending books, let me plug one other that is required reading if you want to understand this election and Republican politics more generally. It's Catherine Kramer's study of Wisconsin politics called The Politics of Resentment. She spent years traveling around the state and talking to ordinary folks. What she finds is that resentment makes politics personal and contributes significantly to polarization. And let me read just one passage from her conclusion. The Republican Party has been very successful at tapping into existing resentments toward particular targets. In the frameworks they provide, the demons are not affluent people, but rather the government, the people that work for it, and urban areas that are home to liberals and people of color. Now keep in mind, Kramer finished her book long before Donald Trump became the Republican Party's presidential nominee. I want to be clear that not everyone voting for Trump scores high on racial resentment. Far from it, I'm sure. But racial resentment is at least one part of the message and the appeal of the Republican Party's nominee. Win or lose, the party faithful are going to have to decide what kind of party they want to be. If we're to have a healthy democracy, we need two healthy parties. And we need partisans of both parties to embrace what the Dartmouth political theorist Russell Muirhead calls ethical partisanship. Let me end by reading Muirhead's own description of ethical partisanship. Ethical partisans stand, and yet know that this is not the only reasonable place one can take a stand. They hope their side wins, yet know that victory should never be total. The most admirable partisans are brave enough to stand up publicly for what they see, yet are capacious enough to know that what they see is not the whole of things. This partisanship is capable of reflecting with some detachment on one's stand, perhaps even able to entertain one's political enemies in grudging good cheer. Such partisans stand, but not unflinchingly. They would flinch at the thought that one side would win a victory that might bring an end to partisanship itself. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tom. I'm a junior. I'm a joint American Studies government major. Hi,
Hi.
Professor Medvic.
How are you?
So, as we saw in California in the early 2000s, a lot of Latino and Hispanic voters whose interests would otherwise lie with the Republican Party have been a consistent Democratic voting bloc in that state ever since. I think it was Gray Davis used a lot of particularly racially tinged rhetoric while running for governor. Do you think the Republican Party in its current state will ever be able to win back that contingent of Latino voters given the rise of Trump and recent rhetoric?
Well, I think you ask a good question because this might be the model for what's happening now. It was Governor Pete Wilson who had supported an anti-immigrant referendum in California, which passed, but which the Republican Party supported and the Democratic Party did not. And Latino voters, you're right. I mean, California used to be a swing state, or at least it was. For long ago, it was a Republican state, and for a while, it was a swing state. It's no longer even close to that, and most people point to that very reason. It's that the party had embraced these anti-immigrant sort of measures. And they completely lost the Latino vote. And this is why the Growth and Opportunity Report in 2012 said we can no longer continue to do that because the nation will look like California if we keep doing that. And so this is why I say I think they have a choice to make. But California, it's a great point because it's the example that the Republican Party, it haunts them, honestly.
Hi, Professor Medvic.
Hi.
I'm Chagwelly. I'm a sophomore. What effect do you think the current candidates will have on more local elections, like the statewide election and the actual local elections?
You mean local, or just not the presidential?
Yeah, level? Just not presidential.
Yeah, so we've seen a clear trend in recent years to straight ticket voting. And this is part of polarization, right? That people go in and they know they're a Republican or they know they're a Democrat and they vote for one party up and down the ballot. I think it's pretty clear that this year we're going to see another uptick in split ticket voting. I think it's probably going to be the case that a lot of Republicans who don't want to vote for Trump will still cross back over to vote for their Senate candidates and their House candidates and down ballot. So I don't know that I think what's behind the question is Trump sort of a drag on Republican candidates, and I'm not sure he's going to be, but you never know. I mean, again, turnout is key here. So if a lot of Republicans just don't want to go out to vote because they can't vote for Trump, and if they're not voting for president, why go to the polls? Down ballot Republicans will suffer. We just don't know what that turnout will look like. Okay. It's a good question, though.
Thanks. Yep.
Hi, my name is Yusra. I'm a sophomore here, and I'm in your class. And I was wondering, how you feel? Do you think a proportional system, turning to a proportional system, except for a majoritarian system that we now have, could potentially fix a bunch of problems such as the representation issue and the resentment issue that you addressed in the U.S. system?
That's a great question. So if we went to a proportional representation system like most other democracies have, you know, what kind of effect would that have? You know, I'm not sure it would do much for polarization, because some of the countries that were ranked higher in polarization than the United States have PR systems. What it might do, though, is allow people to feel as though their voice is being heard. If they could vote for candidates that could win. So the way PR would work is you elect, instead of electing one person per district and the person with the most votes wins, you'd have multiple members, multiple representatives in a larger district, and then you split up the seats proportionally. So if a party gets 20% of the vote, they get 20% of the seats. And so what it does is it creates multiple parties. So PR systems are multi-party systems. Systems like ours are almost always two-party systems. So what it might do is it might allow people to feel that their voice, that their perspective is better represented in Congress or in government. And it might do something to counteract some of the cynicism that we've seen in recent years. I mean, I think one thing that frustrates people, I mean, parties frustrate people, and so in some ways they don't want more of them, but they want more choice. And so I think that I think it would be healthier for democracy if we could do that. The problem is fitting it into our constitutional system. Right? How do you fit PR? You couldn't do it in the Senate, and you can't do it for a single seat like the presidency. So how do you fit it into our system? And that's the tricky thing. I don't know if you could do it just for the House. That might cause other problems.
Hi, thank you. I'm Carol, and I'm a senior citizen. first of all, thank you. It was so lovely to hear your attitude of gratitude at the beginning. That was a lovely thing to hear. Now, you've given so much, so I'm trying to see if I can remember this clearly.
Sure.
You talked about a lot of polls that happened in the spring and in the early summer, and I can't exactly remember what they were showing, except that was before Bernie Sanders threw his support and was asking his supporters to throw his support behind Clinton. And so I wondered if that was indicative of what the polls were showing at that time that you showed up there on the screen.
Yeah.
And also, just one other question, have the polls changed since the first debate? Thank you.
Okay, so most of the things that I showed, the poll results that I showed that might have been from, say, May or something, were the ones about change and people's attitudes towards change, and nothing has changed about those.
But so, if your choice of change at that point was Bernie Sanders or Clinton versus Trump and Clinton,
right?
That might
so be- I picked a series of questions that I thought were most indicative of the desire for change. If you look at newer polls, they show essentially the same thing.
Okay.
I mean, the level of desire for change is exactly the same, and it's historically very high. Now, you asked if the polls had changed yet after the first debate. So what's, not yet. We won't know probably until, I think, maybe tomorrow. We'll start to get the first signs of that. My hunch is that, given some of the polls that asked who won the debate, which pretty overwhelmingly show that Clinton did, my hunch is that there'll be a bump for Clinton, but my hunch is also that that'll dissipate over time. I mean, debates, you know, this is the difficult thing. It's hard to pinpoint the effect of debates and in general, and then in particular one debate. And so most of the political science research says debates can matter at the margins, maybe occasionally if the circumstances are right, you know, but it's just, you can't measure, it's not measurable really, or we don't see it. So I don't know, I assume that things will come back to where they sort of are, which is about 3 or 4 point lead for Clinton.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Chris, I'm a sophomore. I'm curious, what do you think the Democratic and Republic, on the state level, the Republican Party still controls a lot of governorships and state legislators, and I'm curious, how do you think that'll affect what will happen to that party in the next few years?
How that will affect what?
What will happen to the party in the next few years?
Yeah, so they will continue to have strength kind of at the local level, state and local level. For a long time, and that may even mean in the House, right? I mean, so there was some thought that this year maybe Trump would cost Republicans the House of Representatives. That's not gonna happen. The Democrats have to pick up 30 seats to take control of the House, and they're not gonna get anywhere near that. And so, you know, your question points to the fact that when Republicans control governors' mansions and legislatures, they can control the redistricting maps, right? And that gives them an advantage in future elections. And so that, if there's some kind of really widespread change based on the demographic changes we're seeing, it's going to lag behind that political power for a while. So they'll continue to be successful at the state level. It's the question is, you know, can they win at the national level, at the presidency? And this is why they have this difficult split, right? Because what works in a state like Mississippi, maybe, or North Dakota, doesn't necessarily work nationally. And so they have to, that's part of what they have to grapple with, is, you know, people who are successful in states are going to say, well, we are doing it this way and it works, but that's not working at the national level. So they have an extraordinarily difficult problem on their hands. And it's kind of multifaceted. And it's been around for a while and it's been brewing for a while. So I'm not really sure what the answer is going to be. I don't know how they're going to work their way out of it.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hello. Yeah, my name's Jacob. I'm a government major, and I think you know, the peak of your speech was really, like, you know, you relate to, like, polarization to racism, and it was really provocative. And but my question is, like, what is, do you think there's a relationship between social inequality and polarization? Because I remember I read a book by Thomas Piketty, and he has, like, a chart of, like, social, like, income and capital inequality in America, and it looks very, very similar to your chart of polarization. I'm just wondering, like, if there's, like, existed literatures where you have any opinions towards the relationship between those two.
Yeah, so this talk was already too long, so I had to take some things out. One of the images I took out was a graph of the Gini index, the measure of inequality, and how it's grown since the 40s, and the polarization graph that I showed. And they are, it's almost one line. I mean, they map each other almost perfectly. So there are political scientists who argue that there's really a policy cause to polarization, that not fixing economic inequality in complicated ways, but leads to more polarization, and that if we could fix some of the policy, they also show, for example, that immigration goes up, polarization goes up as well. So that suggests a policy remedy. The problem is, the more polarization you have, the less likely you are to pass policies that change these things, right? So we're in this kind of, this cycle that we're not going to be able to break out of. As I said, I think polarization is a kind of normal feature of American politics. If the scholars who make the argument that it's policy-based are right, then it's not a normal feature, it's just the result of things we've done. But other countries are less unequal than us and have higher levels of polarization. So I'm not convinced that those two things are the same, but it's probably not just a coincidence that the level of inequality and the level of polarization have gone up at exactly the same rate over the last 80 years. It's a really good question.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Hallie, and I'm a senior. And my question is in part jumping off of a question earlier.
Okay.
In that Clinton, I don't believe, is, like, representative of the desire for change mm-hmm. within the Democratic Party. So I was wondering why we should consider the Democratic Party a healthy party, mm-hmm. Because it seems as though Clinton is getting her support using resources and also having offices, like, that's kind of what I feel like you were showing here. And how do we have a healthy party system, also a healthy democracy, if it's so dependent on money and, like, essentially marketing?
Yeah, so the money and the marketing and all that stuff is sort of, to me, is a whole nother topic. It's a whole nother part of this. But your question about whether, you know, there are sort of disgruntled and disaffected Sanders supporters who are not happy that Clinton's the nominee, and doesn't that indicate a level of sort of dysfunction or a lack of health in the Democratic Party too? And it's a good question, except that far more Democrats have fallen back in line behind Clinton than have Republicans. I mean, the Republican Trump campaign is running around saying, look at the latest polls, 86%, 85% of Republicans now say they're going to vote for Trump, when it used to be 75% a couple of weeks ago, right? He will lose if he only gets 80. You have to get 90, 92% of your own partisans to vote for you, or you will lose. So he's still not drawing support from as many Republicans as he should. Whereas for Clinton, it's up around 92, 93%. So one sign that it's healthier is that people are falling back in line behind their party's nominee. The other thing is there are no party leaders. The party establishment, no one on the Democratic side has said, I can't vote for, including Bernie Sanders himself, have said, I can't support my party's nominee. So the reason that I say it's an unhealthy party is because there's such a fracture in that party that I'm not sure how you repair it. That fracture doesn't exist in the Democratic Party, but there are divisions. There always are. I mean, this is something I say in class a lot. All politics is coalitional politics. All politics is coalitional politics. In a PR system, as was raised before by Yusra, you build coalitions after the election to try to get a majority to govern. What we do in our system is build coalitions before the election in the two big tent parties, right? So by definition, you have big tent parties that that are going to be made up of lots of different factions, and there's always going to be infighting. But it's nothing compared to what is in the Democratic Party now compared to what it is in the Republican Party. But it's a good question.
68 yeah. election, uh-huh. between the politics of resentment and people's distrust for the government. And while obviously it's a little bit different, this feeling of like, especially with all the shootings this year, like things can't get worse.
Right.
And then something else happens.
Right.
And also like with the third party candidates too. So I was just wondering like what you thought about that.
Yeah, comparison. That is not a bad analogy to 19. So he said, he asked about whether this is like 1968, and it is in some ways. The difference I think I'd say is that the third party candidate in 1968 actually got votes, won electoral college votes. That was a real force in taking votes primarily from the Democratic Party. Now those voters would eventually find their way into the Republican Party, but in 68 they still thought of themselves as Democrats and should have been voting for the Democratic candidate. Couldn't go all the way over to Nixon, so they went to Wallace. The third party candidates this year are going to have nowhere near that effect. I mean, the Johnson campaign is already starting to kind of collapse, and Stein isn't getting any traction. I'd be surprised if any of them got 3% of the vote, whereas Wallace really had an impact that year. But in other ways, sort of, you know, socially, culturally, it does feel the same, right? There's angst, and it's a good observation. Yeah, thanks. We have two more questions.
Hi.
Oh, 2 minutes. One more question then, maybe, unless I answer really quickly.
Hi, I'm Grace. I'm a junior. My question's sort of similar to hers, I guess, sort of building off it, and building off of your response, because you said that there's more Democrats who are now falling in line behind Clinton. I guess, what do you say for the, and I don't know the statistics, I guess, uh-huh. but for those people who are voting for her because of the like lesser of two evils argument, simply because they're like more afraid of a Trump presidency than they are of her being president, but they are still very disgruntled, like you said, and you know, a lot of them are past Bernie supporters, others were not past Bernie, you know, but
yeah.
I mean, what do you, like, does that really show that the party is healthy, I guess?
I think it does. I think that's healthy, normal party politics. You wanted your candidate to win, your candidate didn't win, you stay in the party, you vote for the nominee, and you try to change it later, right? You stay in the party and try to fix it and move it in your direction. And look, Sanders has moved Clinton to the left, and he'll be a voice, along with Elizabeth Warren, to keep the party to the left. And that's a good thing. That's a healthy thing. That kind of tug of war within the party is not a bad thing at all. That doesn't show a sign of a lack of health. I think that's actually that's healthy party politics. But voting for her as the lesser of two evils, welcome to a two-party system. I mean, that's what you often have to do, right? I mean, I really feel bad saying this, but look, Clinton or Trump is going to win, right? If you vote for a third party candidate in a battleground state, it is just a fact, again, don't shoot the messenger, it's just a fact that you are helping the your least favorite major party candidate. It's just, and that's a structural problem, right? It's the system. And I know that's hard for people to grapple with, you know, with their conscience, but that's just the way the system works.
And that's gonna have to be our last question, so please join me in thanking Professor Medvic.